It's a warmly persuasive word to describe an existing set of relationships. It's a word that seems only to convey positive connotations. Nobody can be against it or feel threatened by it, I think. The reason for popularity of the word is not hard to seek. Desire for community is deep. Christian members of one body expressing yearning for communion with God and for each other, secular yearning for social wholeness, a national and international appeal for unity, cohesion and common purpose, an egalitarian desire to break down divisions of wealth and geography, support for existing relationships and social organisations, service to the community. Good, bold, positive phrase. Is anybody here against community? Raise your hand if you're against it. Fine. Why?
Well, it could be say nationalism, clash of communities.
Well done. There's always one. That's good, because of course it's not quite that simple. Take the European community. Take the Nazis talking about the people's community. Over the years, over the decades, the word obviously has sometimes been used in ways that aren't quite so warmly persuasive. So it can be, as it were, commandeered, distorted from those positive meanings that I've summarised from Williams. The distinction in German between Gemeinschaft, real, warm, interacting, reciprocating community, as in all the positive meanings I've mentioned, and Gesellschaft, the more formal, contractual, legal, and abstract relationships through state and society. That distinction is an interesting one, and of course the latter relates more to the negative feelings that can be attached to community. Within the British tradition, there's been a strong communitarian ideal from John Ruskin, William Morris, through to the idea of community education. Another Morris, Henry Morris, created village colleges in rural Cambridgeshire. He was one of the earliest writers to use the term community education, 1920s. In the late 1930s and early 1940s, when we got the Butler Education Act, writing about county colleges and the idea of community schools, ideas extending from the village college to urban locations. The village college was an attempt to attack rural decline, community school and college attacking urban decline, especially in inner cities. By the early 1960s, from the USA, we had concepts of poverty and the disadvantaged, leading to issues of compensatory education linked with community education. That's been a very strong thread since that time. In the 60s, there was a Jules Pfeiffer cartoon. I used to think I was poor. Then they told me I wasn't poor, I was needy. Then they told me, self-defeating to think of myself as needy, I was deprived. Then they told me, deprived was a bad image, I was underprivileged. Then they told me underprivileged was overused, I was disadvantaged. I still don't have a dime, but I've got a great vocabulary. That is a pregnant cartoon, which in many ways is still applicable, I think, to the way your words can be used, and the difficulty with words, because they can carry, or be felt to carry, negative connotations sometimes when people are particularly in a position to manipulate. Compensatory education programs were devised and implemented for students of all ages in the USA and then in Britain from the Plowden Report in 1967 with recommendations for educational priority areas. Some of you might remember EPAs, educational priority areas. In the early 1970s, developing a working philosophy of school-based community education centres around the concept of compensatory education, giving priority to disadvantaged, especially in cities. Some money came through from the government, not much, for community development projects. The WEA became involved with an EPA, Educational Priority Area, project in central Liverpool. The WEA in Liverpool was in the vanguard with joint LEA provision from 1967. Quote, joint provision of community adult education with staff freed from the usual trammels of convention imposed by traditional methods. That was David Connor, the district secretary at the time, defining what they were doing, breaking through into community education. In 1969, Tom Lovett was appointed 3 years post for doing pioneering work with, for the urban working class in Liverpool. His book, Adult Education, Community Development and the Working Class, describes that 3 years of work in this city. He quoted Freire and Illich from Brazil and Chile. Basically, the idea was start where people are, use their knowledge, use their culture, don't try to impose from without. That was the philosophy. And the Liverpool EPA project was using school and the community school, but with a team member responsible for adult education, with the professional adult educator creating a learning network based on the interests of the community, getting involved in the community organisations. Tom Lovett quotes about this experience, and I'll just want to read a bit about it because it summarises, I think, a key issue in this, which comes through maybe to today, and community publishers. By the early 1980s, sales from the various groups under that umbrella reached 500,000. So quite a significant development within community education, community publishing. The Federation, however, collided with the Arts Council. The Arts Council, considering grants to this project, decided that they were producing work of little literary merit, and the grant was cut. Greg Wilkinson, involved in the project, wrote to Sir Roy Shaw, Director General of the Arts Council, from a worker writers and community publication perspective, critical of the then top-down community arts two-tier system as being hierarchical and elitist. Out of these conflicts, there was some value out of the ferment and the arguments because they broke the rigidities and barriers between practical, academic and appreciatory courses in adult education. Until that point, there'd been fairly strict, rigid distinctions between those three activities within adult education. John Denham, writing the consultative paper when defining this, aware that adult education had lost at least 2 million students, that is your normal evening class, day class, fee-paying students, over the 3 years from 2005 to 2008, when he wrote the consultation paper, but he said, but actually there's a lot of informal adult learning going on. The U3A, book groups, reading groups, and if you add the National Trust members, 3 million or so, who all of whom, by definition, if you join the National Trust, you're involved in informal learning because you visit some place and you're learning. Brilliant. there's millions of adult learners in the country. If you're a government, that's brilliant because it's cheap. So there's been a shift. And that's now, of course, where we are. And my last 5 or 10 minutes, I want to raise questions from that history relating to where we are now are in 2011. Radically different world, obviously. That tradition I've been describing in the 70s and 80s, dead. There are no extramural departments anymore, or they're much diminished. The WEA's experienced changes, whereby pretty well everything now is work-related in terms of getting the funding for it. And everything is much more instrumental. The old adult education landscape is bleak and impoverished. Community schools, well, yes, there are still some you could argue, but most schools have so many problems with the kids and with everything else we know about all the problems of schools and financing and so on. There's no time or energy or resources for adults to join in, as was the old community school idea. But, as we know, there's actually a lot of interest going on, often below the radar, with little funding, voluntary and informal. There are weaknesses with the voluntary and informal, as we know. I could summarise that in this way. Professionals, on the whole, if they're sensible, work to avoid redundancy, their own redundancy. Volunteers, however, ideally, should be working to make themselves redundant. I want to be redundant in my voluntary work that I'm doing for the Raymond Williams Foundation. I'd be very happy for somebody else to take it on. But we all know the problem with many voluntary organisations are that it's not easy. There aren't that many people coming through to take it on. That's a problem, I think. But it's one that needs to be constantly addressed. It's got more difficult now, of course, with cuts in funding, related to the big society, which you talked about earlier. It's actually getting more difficult for charities to run, with predictions, serious predictions, that the number of charities in this country will decline by about a third over the next 2 or 3 years. Nevertheless, there's a lot of interest going on. As I've mentioned, the U3A book groups, literary and arts festivals, Hey on Why, thriving, with philosophy discussions now added to their programmes, and of course PIPS. PIPS is a phenomenon, and not just PIPS, of course, because at the same time, concurrent with PIPS, there have been other developments, pretty similar. I mean, we in Leek started our pub discussion group 6 years ago, and with the long, clumsy title when we started it, of the WEA William Morris Study Circle in Leek. William Morris, because he lived in Leek in the 1870s, and there was a William Morris Labour Church which survived for 30 years at the start of the last century. And when I started the project in Leek, it was the idea of revisiting the William Morris Labour Church idea, but updating as it were by 6 or 7 decades. Basically, the William Morris Labour Church had as its key aim to argue about, to debate and discuss big issues, and that's what we've been doing over the last 6 years. And that's led to spin-off work, as you may have heard already, at two or three other locations in North Staffordshire. And of course, there's Café Philosophique, the Sidebars, Salon, other groups, voluntary groups, not funded, but doing their own, but working in certain ways in a similar direction. Many positive features. Anarchic, in a sense, in the best sense, because working bottom up. Something we can learn from that earlier community education I've outlined, I think, is that there are certain dangers in the top-down funded community education, for the reasons that I outlined. working bottom-up in a voluntary way, one can perhaps, in certain ways, avoid some of the difficulties of that early, those earlier tensions and ideological difficulties. We've also now, of course, got the benefits of new technologies, email, the web, using the media, using Facebook. Somebody sent me only 10 days ago from our group in Leek, the YouTube RSA Animate. Is anybody familiar with that? RSA Animate. On changing educational paradigms. Quite brilliant. 11-minute program of stimulus. Very challenging argument presented about what's wrong with current education. In my view, pretty stimulating at least, and probably accurate as well. That kind of development is flourishing. And of course, we've now got web communities. But of course, we can't beat the face-to-face meetings. That's the value, obviously, of an event like this. To meet, as I've done with a number of people here, through email, so to speak. That can be a community of a kind, but the face-to-face meetings are most valuable. Non-ideological, in the negative sense of that term, but aware, most of us, that nothing can be neutral. Anything you do, in my view, is not neutral as such in an absolute sense, and that's an important point to make when one's discussing social and political and theological issues. But nevertheless, one can, through the open, pluralist, non-dogmatic learning from one another way, not allow that problem to get in the way, so to speak. Our Raymond Williams Foundation had a weekend some years ago on community. And what we found was, on that weekend, most of us on that weekend agreed that we actually formed a community on that weekend, even though many of us only met once a year. Because meeting over several years, actually certain kinds of relationships, certain kinds of bonding takes place, and that itself can be a community. And I'm quite sure that many of the groups meeting in pubs, cafes and so on, similar things go on. Meeting only once a week, once a month or whatever, nevertheless, communities develop. The Raymond Williams Foundation is helping try to extend this non-formal, informal networking to build on the best of what occurred in those earlier decades, because we all recognise and still learn, and learn very effectively, from professionally taught courses, from lectures, from gatherings where somebody is paid to do something, and we are helping to fund day schools and residential weekends to keep the cost down, to enable many of the people who are attending the informal work to better participate in the more formal. And that, it seems to me, is an important pattern for the future. And if Paul, inspired by the success of this and getting such a good rate at this hotel for this weekend, wants to think big for next year, he might take the holiday camp idea and think of a bigger gathering for all the families and everything else like I described. Arthur's not looking too pleased or impressed with that, maybe.
Depends on the weather.
Yes, he hasn't got a care by out of
it. Yeah. Anyway, what we've got, I think, is the germination of arguably a new kind of development, a new kind of movement, even, one might say. It's difficult to define. I've just revisited this book by Simon Critchley, Simon Critchley is a professor of philosophy, highly regarded in the professional circles. I hesitate to recommend this book. Parts of it are fiendishly difficult to understand, I find. But I think he's onto something big, and it might be worth me rereading it, and indeed, with that qualification I've given to you, you considering it. What he basically argues is that we're moving into a position potentially of anarchic metapolitics. Metapolitics meaning big scale politics, a crossing many boundaries. Anarchic in the best sense of the term, meaning non-governmental, top-down kind of politics, because he has quite a long section in this, which was only written about 3 or 4 years ago, and if anything, his argument on this point I'm summarising now is probably strengthened, not weakened since then. He's saying that so many people are cynical, disillusioned with party politics as they have existed in recent years, and particularly party political leaders, and the kind of top-down implementation of politics coming from that, that there is a kind of welling up of cynicism, but cynicism is negative, of course. The positive side, the other side of that, is a recognition that maybe we should reject that and move to something different, seek to address the issues. And I'm very interested in these developments now through the web. I don't know whether many of you know Open Democracy Net on the web. Fascinating website, constantly replenishing itself with serious articles about international affairs and politics, available to everybody, accessible to everybody. 38 Degrees, my guess is that many people here know about 38 Degrees, petitions which have now had quite an impact, a measurable impact, even on government, coalition government policies. Avaaz, an international network similar to 38 Degrees. I find I'm now voting personally at least 5 times a week. And the votes are beginning to mount up, and they're beginning to count, which is an interesting phenomenon. However, of course, there's a downside to that, because of course that can be manipulated itself, applied in non-progressive ways, outright right-wing ways, but nevertheless, given the nature of the web, given the nature of email and so on, we can use it positively in the ways that I would link to the kind of definitions of community education I've outlined. And then if you link that to everything that's now going on all over the planet, like the use of mobiles and emails and Twitter and Facebook in the the Arab Spring, and countries like Tunisia and Egypt, where there have been very positive uses of that kind of media. There are ways, I think, of seeing this and us, what we're doing, as part of a general phenomenon which does carry, I think, positive possibilities. And I want to finish by just reading some quotes from the old Arab education tradition, which I think can weave into this project if we approach it with that positive attitude. R.H. Tawney used to use the term about his experience of the WEA with workers, genuine workers, this is back in the 1910s and 20s, build from within, the idea of building upwards from within. Early WEA and Labour College activists used the term education by collision. By that they meant through debate and discussion and argument, you get education. It's the collision of ideas, ideologies, which can itself foster good education. I like an early WEA radical slogan from the West Country, down with all that's up. The idea that you are cynical, opposed to those up on high. Everything should be grassroots, bottom up. Then there's the quote, tell me and I'll forget, teach me and I'll remember, involve me and I'll learn. Very germane for the kind of small group discussion that Pips is involved in, as we are in Leek. And an old Colleg Harlech Welsh quote, Arvo Bid Pont, she who is a leader, let her be a bridge. It's usually translated, he who is a leader, but I'm updating it for this audience, of course. Building bridges between all the positive community education projects, groups and networks that we are involved in and know a way about, that's the way forward.
Thanks very much for that, Derek.
Well, what I'm interested in, right, is that when you were speaking about adult education being instrumental, that you made the point that I didn't fully understand about adult education seeming to have shifted at some point to a more instrumental basis, and that you said that that the old adult education landscape was impoverished. And obviously, I've not experienced the, you know, what adult education may have been like in the past. My experience of it has been always that everybody who's attending, they're from different walks of life and from different angles, but they're all there for an instrumental function. They want to achieve something. And perhaps I've missed out on something by this, but I'm trying to understand why you seem to see this as a critique.
I was linking that also to some degree to the instrumental point. There's nothing whatsoever wrong in my view in anybody doing something for instrumental reasons. Instrumental in the sense of that you defined. But of course, adult education used to embrace other values as well as, no disrespect to the instrumental, but other values as well, as was expressed through the idea of community education, as was expressed through the idea of social and political education. Social and political education isn't necessarily, for the individual concerned, directly instrumental in the usual sense of that term, seems to me. may carry certain instrumental values, but it's got a other range of connotations and meanings, and that's what I meant. And of course, adult education, as it was known, even 10 years ago, has shrunk because of funding cuts, but not just because of funding, but because of bureaucracy and a heavy emphasis on paperwork and evaluation over the top, so that many people who, in every level of adult education as it was known, have pulled back. There are fewer involved.
It's incomparable. Slums, back-to-back houses, children leaving school at a young age, uneducated, illiterate parents. All of that contributed to the adult education movement when it developed in industrialized societies. It's not there anymore. Thankfully, we've come on a long way. We're much better than that. So I'm not really sure about, being instrumental. It was true, and I'm not even sure what proportion of people benefited from it.
Are attending than they did 4 years ago. That's all I was making, that there has been a radical diminution of that tradition.
I enjoyed Derek's talk on community education because it was very much about empowering adults to carry on learning, you know, and to become empowered better thinkers, which is something that our society seems to need, you know. And it's a shame that the WEA, as Derek was saying, was cut a while ago, and there hasn't been much adult education since the 80s, and it's really something that this society needs. So it's nice to be here, hearing somebody say that, you know. And, you know, to be witnessing somebody who's done something about it, who started groups and, you know, used to work in Burton Manor and this kind of thing. So it's just very encouraging, you know, it's positive, progressive.
Raymond Williams himself taught for 15 years in adult education, mainly through the WEA, so he knew adult education very well. And he wrote books whilst teaching adult education, which established his name, Culture and Society, The Long Revolution, broad political, social, literary books, and he gained a big reputation. And then he moved to Cambridge after 15 years of that. And he'd been there one or two years when I went to Cambridge. So I knew his name, I knew of his reputation. I got to know him personally through my activities in CND in Cambridge, in which he was also active. So when he agreed to teach me, that was within the literature tripos at Cambridge. So it was, of course, about tragedy, about Dickens, about big literature themes. And he was teaching me in my final year, once a week, so I got to know him quite well. And as I say, after that, I moved on in the way I've described. So when he died, we established this fund at Barlaston. And since that was 1988, he died then. And that was when the fund was established. The fund was to help adult students attend residential courses on Raymond Williams type themes. What was that? Literature, politics, media, social, very broad range, but with a strong social political emphasis. Oh no, the WEA and other adult education courses had run in international affairs, literature, politics and so on for decades. But what was new about this was that this was a fund to help provide bursaries to establish courses mainly at Barlaston, not solely at Barlaston, in Raymond Williams's name, on these themes, an annual course engaging with these big issues related to his work. Now that was new, that link was new. And those, well, the college is a relatively small residential college. Yes, it's a college, residential college, linked by a network to other residential colleges at the time across the country. So for instance, although we established these residential courses at Barlaston, in the way I've described, filling the college, that is with 35, 40 adults from all over the country, because that's the limit for residents. But we also ran a residential weekend at the Hill in Abergavenny, very near to where Raymond Williams was born, on his last big novel, The People of the Black Mountains. So the project, if you like, was that, running these courses with a small fund. We only were spending a few hundred pounds a year just to help a few individuals who couldn't afford the low fees. The fees were relatively low anyway at that time, but some people, of course, couldn't afford residential fees, so we provide a few bursaries so that we widen the participation, exactly as Raymond Williams had wanted, committed to the adult education tradition of workers' education.
So how's that expanded over the years?
Well, that's expanded in the sense that those courses have run for 24 years now. But some years ago, a long-standing supporter of these courses, a really interesting guy whose name was Dudley Pretty, former trade unionist, former WEA, relatively young man, and he died relatively young, heart attack, in his 50s, unknown to us, he had quite a lot of money. And I didn't know. In fact, he looked a bit like a tramp, and we'd provided him with bursaries, you know, financial bursaries to help him. When he died, unknown to us, he'd left a bequest, his whole estate, to our then Raymond Williams Memorial Fund. So our fund jumped suddenly from a few thousand pounds to £200,000. This was, we eventually got the money. There was quite a long legal delay. We eventually got the money in 2008. So that's enabled us now to, through this leaflet, expand our support to this project. So since 2008, we've given more support to the residential weekend at Barlaston, but we've also run other residential weekends elsewhere. We've given subsidies to day schools elsewhere, for instance in Berwick-upon-Tweed, a day school on democracy. We provide a few hundred pounds to lower the fee so that pretty well everybody who wants to can attend.